Paleontology is the study of how life on our planet looked in the past. Paleontologists search for traces of past living animals and plants, which are called fossils, to put together the pieces of a puzzle that formed our planet's history.
It's not like when people put together a puzzle that you get out of a box, because it's really more like a puzzle where 80 to 90% of the pieces are missing. The ones that you do have are broken, and there's no picture on the box that shows you what it should look like.
Justin Hall is a PhD paleontology student at the Los Angeles Natural History Museum. The animal of study in this case is the Microraptor, a four-winged flying dinosaur. Justin explains that the very first step to solve the puzzle of flight is to figure out what the original flying dinosaur looked like.
And what you really have to do is know what that picture should look like by knowing what other animals look like and knowing what other things do. And you sort of fill that information back in and reconstruct the whole thing. In certain cases, we get really, really lucky and we get very complete specimens, like our Tyrannosaur downstairs is somewhere around 80% complete, which is just ridiculously complete. We almost never get that. It's usually, if you have 30%, we're really, really happy. So that's one of the things that's really fun about it, because you get to use your imagination and creativity and sort of mental visualization powers to fill in what the rest of that animal looks like.
Justin tries to figure out the behavior of the Microraptor by comparing it with birds and crocodiles, two of the closest living relatives of dinosaurs.
What you can do then is if there's a behavior that both crocodiles and birds do, you can safely start to assume that maybe dinosaurs did that. And then you can look at the skeleton for evidence for it, you can look at eggshell, things like that, and you can try to figure out behavior that dinosaurs did by comparing their living relatives.
One of the key features to identify a dinosaur is a perforate acetabulum. What?
It's a really complicated way of saying that the hip has a hole in it, so the hip socket actually has a hole. And into that, the femur, which is the thigh bone, has a little ball on the end, and the ball sits inside the hole. So it's actually structured very similar to how our hip is, where we have a little socket and then a ball that sits in there.
Scientists who previously studied the Microraptor indicated that they flew with the back wings spread out to the side, as if they were doing the splits. These authors argued that both back and front wings were used at the same level, held horizontally to the ground, to increase lift and help the animal glide.
We didn't like the idea because we don't think the animal can physically do that. We don't think its legs bend that way. Everybody probably knows people that can do the splits. Nobody knows anybody that goes around doing it as part of how they get around in their daily life. It just doesn't make sense. It's not comfortable for them to do it. Even if they can do it, it's not something they can do really, really easily.
So the anatomy and the biomechanics are saying no. The back wings are not used for gliding. But we are still stuck with a puzzle piece that doesn't fit anywhere. What are the back wings used for? To explain how these wings are working, Justin compares the wings with when you stick your hand out of the window of a car. As the air comes in, it's going to push and pop your hand up. That popping up is lift. As you rotate your hand, you're going to catch more and more air. The air pushing back is drag.
What Microraptor's doing is it's basically turning a wing on edge like this, and then with that air that's coming in as it's flying, if it turns that wing surface to the side, just like your hand will pop and deflect off to the side, it's gonna do the same thing with that leg. It's gonna produce a ton of drag on the feathers that are sticking off the back leg, and as the animal turns, when any flying thing turns, a plane, a bird, anything, it banks its whole body. And so when it does that, if it just leaves those legs sticking straight down and doesn't do anything unusual with them, but as it banks its body, let's see, as it banks its body, those legs that are sticking down here are gonna start to produce drag and start to produce a little bit of lift in this direction. And what happens is it kind of slows the animal down and then it turns faster.
What's happening is that instead of using front and back wings at the same time, Microraptors found a way to use the wings to produce drag, which can help them turn between 40 to 180% faster, making really sharp cuts through the air.
We know this animal lives in an environment with lots and lots of trees around, so this is a huge, huge advantage to something that has to dodge objects pretty much every time it's in the air.
The birds you see flying in the air today have adapted the mechanism from the Microraptor to become the advanced flying creatures that they are today. Justin explains how the model he created supported this idea.
It's really neat because all you have to do is basically give something feathers and make the tail longer. Then you can get it into the air. Now modern birds have really advanced control structures. They do most stuff with their front wings, really advanced slat tips and things that they can do to help them maneuver. But in order to get to that point, you have to have something in the air and start evolving. Like you can't just evolve that. It doesn't make sense to evolve that while you're still a ground-dwelling animal. So what's really cool about this model is it provides a plausible way to get those dinosaurs into the air and then start selecting on it to ultimately wind up with modern birds. At first we're a little bit concerned, what if, you know, we're making a pretty big step in saying that this four-winged flight is possibly how birds evolve flight and that it happened with dromaeosaurs. We may be wrong. But the key point to keep in mind is that if you're not ever wrong, you're probably not doing interesting enough stuff because you're not pushing your boundaries, you're not trying to challenge and do what you can.
Want to play the paleontology puzzle? Access now the Curiosity Machine.